Welcome everybody on today's sit down episode. On today's episode, ladies and gentlemen, we have the most awarded media owner of 2021 with 30 years in sales, marketing and advertising. He's renowned for creating high performance sales cultures with a sharp focus on customer centricity. He has rallied at every single level of the business to engage and connect, facing the ongoing challenges head on with solutions-based thinking and bucket loads of empathy. Our guest today always demands professionalism and excellence. He has massive capacity to read and stay informed and shares his knowledge freely. He's outspoken about human rights and is not afraid to speak his mind on topics that get involved. His latest mission is to debunk vaccination myths and spread as much real and scientific news as possible. Last but certainly not least, he's a true gentleman with a sense of family and integrity. At his core, the only reason that he stands on top of the media and marketing mountain is because he has his hand out pulling everybody up. Smart, systematic, leader amongst leaders, but most importantly, a synergist. The Silver Fox, Mr. Wayne Bischoff. Welcome to our show, sir.
Thank you so much. What a cool intro.
I am so excited and nervous. I'm breaking out in a sweat to have such a profile person as you today on our episode. We are truly honored, sir. Thank you for allowing us.
I'm honored as well. Absolutely honored to be here.
You know, you've had an incredible journey. I mean, your intro should have been like 90 minutes because you've done it all, sir. But I always want to kick off with my favorite question. If we could go back a couple of years, like 3 or 4 years, you're 17, boom, walk through the door, you know, tall, handsome, sit on this couch. And who are you at 17? What are you prioritizing? What's important to you at that age?
Sure, 17, I was in matric. I only got my license in November of matric, yes, but I was still driving as we did in those days, you know.
Yes, we did.
and I was very keen to make sure I had the best biceps in those days, because I'd wear my vest and put that sort of tropical blend suntan lotion on.
Sun's out, guns out.
It was all about the look and the hair and you know, the proper mirror Ray-Ban shades. I look back and I'm embarrassed, you know, but that was what it was about back then. And I suppose it was a totally, you know, just chilled out life and parties back then. Obviously girls. Matric wasn't the most important thing in my life. It was, you know, what am I gonna do next year? Is it varsity? Is it the army? What was it all about? So it was a very kind of like happy-go-lucky lifestyle, even though it was a particular period in this country, obviously. But yeah, it was just chilled, loved my car. I'll tell you more about that in a moment. And yeah, I wish if I looked back then, I thought I would have clapped myself a little bit. Looking at my son, is the same age as I was then. That trick, he studies all the time. He's focused. He knows who he's going to do next year. You know, I wish I had him teaching me when I was his age. So, it's a very different era.
The reason why I love that question, sir, is because it gives all of us the confidence to say, you know what, even you didn't have it all figured out at that age. Even you weren't as systematic as your boy is today. And yeah. I mean, look at the massive achievements that you've had over your career. And I mean, you're just getting started. You're very young. You're full of energy. The guns are still
there. Not about the very young, but
you are. You really are. So it just gives us confidence that even the greats didn't have it all figured out at the age of 17.
That's so true. I mean, I really didn't know. I mean, at one stage, my father wanted me to go into similar industry that his family had been in, which is like optometry and, you know, and eye doctors and eye surgeons. And who knew I was going to get into the media and advertising and marketing game? I didn't have a clue. I was going to go into, eventually when I got into university, labor relations, you know, that side of industrial relations. That was where I thought my path was going to be. And you kind of fell into. And I've loved it. It's worked out. It's kind of the slot that I think suits me and has suited me best.
I absolutely agree. If it hasn't suited you, you would have never achieved the massive amounts of success that you have. So if you don't mind, like, what happens? You know, sun's out, guns out, you finish matric, you've got the aviators on, a cool car. How do you navigate into the industry, and is it a straight path to success, or was there a few wiggles along the way?
No, there have definitely been a few wiggles along the way, as there always are, and I think that's where you learn from. You know, if you fail, you know, you stand up and you learn from those failures and you move on. So you need those failures to get to the next level and to learn from them. But I mean, I went through university, did my honors in industrial sociology. It was all about, you know, the labor side of the marketplace. Ended up going to London, and no one needed South African trained industrial sociologists for some strange reason.
In London, really? They didn't?
I didn't need me. And I was staying with a best friend of mine in South London, a place called Red Hill.
How old are you then?
Probably 22, I think,
wow,
around there.
Man.
And I saw an ad saying graduates wanted, you know, advertising telesales for Classic Car magazine.
Wow.
So I went, okay. So I went for the job interview and I got it. And that's where I got into the first job into advertising media. It was this group that had Classic Car magazine, yachting magazines. They had a whole lot of car magazines as well, and a whole lot of great editors there used to run the classic car shows in Birmingham. So I got into that. My clients were all north of England and the USA. So I had people like exporting, you know, old 1950s Jaguars from California, rust-free. And they were like advertising with me to get into the market, because classic cars was the game back then. And that got me into designing ads, helping clients, you know, get leads, and I stayed in that, you know, magazines, media, and eventually, you know, many years later, done pretty much all media types, and I got hooked into it, you know. So it's interesting.
Very. And at what age do you come back to South Africa? Do you stay there a while?
I stayed there nearly 5 years in the UK, and I came back in 91, and, you know, got back into magazines, and I came back and thought, will I stay here, won't I stay here? It's kind of, I've got to a point where if I stayed any longer in London, I would have just stayed forever. And
gotcha.
This is still my home. So let me come back and see if I can live. Things are opening up. And I came back, my mother was obviously here, my father, and I got into media, and I ended up at 702 Talk Radio.
At 702, your first job in
South Africa. Job really in audio and radio, and that, there was no other media title. There was SABC, and there was 702. There was no Prime Media then. It was the days of Stan Katz, and it was exciting and energetic and an amazing place to be.
And do you bring back with you from London a different perspective or an edge, or are you coming into an environment? Perhaps my question is, do you have the upper hand on the local talent, or are you, you know, Is it a competition that's at a equal level, in your opinion, at that time?
I think there's different skills. So
different skills.
When I went in there, I was very nervous because everyone had been there quite a while. They were seen as like the top media owners in the industry. The marketing sales team were like the best of the best. So I was very nervous coming in there. I even loaned a friend's fancy blazer to go to the first client's thing there with them. And they were a fun bunch, amazing bunch. But the skills I brought from the UK were the training was exceptional when I was there. I worked at the last job in the UK was for Yellow Pages, which then was the Google of its day. There was no Google, so Yellow Pages was Google. Every business had to be in the Yellow Pages.
Yes.
They had 66 directories around the country. There were like, I think, 9 for London alone. I had a whole patch of South and Southeast London. The training was a month long, based in the countryside, like at a hotel where they filmed you. They went through everything, the understanding of the client's needs. It was an amazing, amazing training back then. And that's still, I still even have that knowledge today.
Beautiful.
You know, about customer service, understanding a client's needs. And so that I think gave me a bit of a heads up when I came back in. So I didn't ever get back in industrial relations or labor movement stuff or unions or HR. I stuck in media, and that was the game from then on.
Thank goodness, because I mean, you've brought so much value into an industry, into people's lives, and obviously into the marketplace because of everything that you've done. If you today think back to, you know, the 23, 24-year-old version of you going into media, and I know there's a million things that you take back with you, but what's the one or two maybe mindsets or mind shifts that you've developed over the years that perhaps our audience can say, okay, that really makes sense. I'm going to deploy this in my life. That, and you said everything happens for you because that's how you learn and grow. But maybe we can change somebody's career to a promotion and shrink it down from 4 years to 3 years or to 2 years.
I think the most important thing for me, if I look back, is having a passion for what you do. Because if you're passionate for what you do, and you're passionate for what let's think back to the great clients I had way back with the 702. If you're passionate for what those clients are trying to achieve, and you go the extra mile for them, and you really want to help them. You're not thinking about the cash or the commission. You're thinking about, I want to help them grow their business or do great things with their business. It's all about those outcomes, and the rewards follow you. And that's to be in such good stead that years and years later, some of those clients who are now senior people in the industry remember those days. And they remember how I made them feel. I think it's how you make people feel that's really important. But to me, it's passion. It's gaining the trust of people. It's always going the extra mile. And not being selfish about it. The rewards will come. But if you really focus on doing the best you can for your clients and customers, and also the people around you, being kind to people, that stands you in good stead. So that's something I've always stuck by. One thing I would advise my younger self to have been doing at the age of 24, whatever, would be to probably started saving a lot sooner.
Saving.
Yeah, because those days, whatever you earned, you just spent, right? That was what, your car, you out for drinks, whatever, you didn't think about anything.
Yeah.
So now I look at some of the youngsters that work for me now, and they're thinking ahead, they're thinking of buying this, investing in property, having, investing in shares, whatever, and I wouldn't have thought of that back then. You live the kind of now.
I agree. I think financial literacy is, in my opinion, in my humble opinion, is a global problem, not only a South African problem, but I think it's quite large here. We don't get any financial literacy at school.
No, we don't.
We unfortunately don't. I'm fascinated by leadership, and you are a phenomenal leader. I don't use the word synergist lightly because, I mean, off camera we spoke, you've got we've got Kai FM and we've got Jacaranda, and I know some of the lions that you lead in Jacaranda, like, wow. I'm like super, super impressed with the leadership team that you've set up. This is a personal question. In a sales team, you drive sales teams, what do you look for in a greenie, so somebody that just enters? These are the three or four qualities that I like seeing in a young person that's coming into my team, and sort of mid-level management. And who, in your opinion, or what qualities do you admire, that do you look for in a more senior manager? What makes you say, I'm going to lock onto you, I'm going to spend some time on you and develop you?
Yeah, I think from a sales point of view, you can get some guys who just think of sales. They want to, they're brilliant at their job. They're not thinking about the rest of the team around them. But if they have the right attitude, in the old days you say employ an attitude, train on skill. So you can take a youngster in who has a brilliant attitude, you just feel that this person will understand how to market and sell. Yes. We don't do that a lot these days. We want people with experience to come straight in and slot in and hit the ground running. But back in the day, when I think we had more time to gently take people in and train them up, attitude was number one. Someone who had the sparkle in their eyes, who wanted to just go the extra mile and work hard and learn all the time and come to you. And people will say, you must, I want someone to mentor me. Well, then go to them, say, I want you to mentor me. I want to learn from you. So those youngsters used to come to me and say, I want to learn from you. How do you do this? What do you do there? I've got a challenge here. How would I resolve it a lot easier? And make plans to get to know everyone in the organization who can assist them in getting stuff done for their clients. So those are the guys I look for.
And
also people that challenge the status quo.
Yes.
I say to people coming to the company now, don't just come in and accept the way things have always been done. I say, I want you to challenge things. It doesn't look right. It doesn't make sense. Ask why. Keep asking why. Can it be done better?
Yeah.
Challenge. But give a solution.
Yeah.
And people like that are the people I see, obviously, going the extra mile. And these are the people I look for leadership. They're challenging. They're looking for solutions. And they're also helping people around them. I'm almost morphing into the looking for leadership qualities here and promotions. But get involved. Don't just think of number one being yourself. Think of the organization. The most important person still will be your client. That's number one. Then think of the organization, and think of yourself and your peers around yourself, because sometimes you might not be around, they're going to jump in and help you.
Yes.
So always have this team playing kind of ethos, but always think, I want to build trust with my clients, I want to go the extra mile, I'm going to challenge things, I'm going to try different things, and I'm not afraid to suggest things. So in the old days, you just came and you sat quiet and just did what you were told to do. I don't want those people.
You love opposing opinion.
They got to think differently. They got to challenge. They got to think, what if, what if, what if? And old legacy companies, and our company is a legacy company, it's 25 years old.
Yes.
You know, things have always been done a certain way, so don't change it. Now, I said that at SABC, it didn't go down very well with the general manager there. I said, well, if it ain't broke, break it, you know.
Okay,
you know,
love it.
Challenge things. You know, if it ain't broke, break it. Is there a better way of doing it? And that's what I want people to challenge, because it's the only way you're going to iterate, be agile, and improve and grow as a company and as a human being.
I think it's a valid point, because if you look in America, the Fortune 500 mm-hmm. companies that have lasted over the last 50 years, most probably only, you know, very low team percentile that mm-hmm. have lasted, because most of them, I mean, we can talk big brands that have fallen, and recently, because they don't accept the constant change. That's the only constant. It's the change, challenge, opposing opinion. I love it. And there's a difference between what you said. If you're coming up with if you're raising a problem, you're putting a problem on the table, and you are supporting it with a solution that's logical, beautiful, but I also feel sometimes people just raise problems. This is wrong. This is wrong. This is wrong. Yeah. So that's a different kind of
the whiners. They're whiners in every organization. Yes. They just whine, and you say, well, what would you do differently? Then they got to go think about it.
Yes.
But you know, because I don't have all the solutions. And sometimes people, older school ways are looking and saying, you're the boss. You must have the solution for me. And I turn it around. Well, what do you guys think? How should we do this thing differently? I have a strategic leadership team. We discuss things. How should things be done differently? How can we go forward? How can we iterate? Where should we look for new opportunities? Don't rely on one person, because I want to have the best people on my team to do the things I can't do or can't think about. So you need a really good team around you. But the biggest thing for me in this modern age is keep challenging the way things have always been done and see if there's a better way of doing it. And always think of the outcomes for your customers. How are you going to make their lives better? You know? And obviously, as I said, most important market are staff.
Yeah.
Look after your staff, and they'll look after the clients and look after the business. That to me is number one. I've been in companies, no names mentioned, media companies, where your staff weren't looked after. And the turnover of staff's high, clients aren't happy, it just multiplies throughout. So
growth is stunned.
People are critical. Looking after people and giving the opportunity to grow in a company is critical.
Beautiful. I love the fact that off camera you said, you know, you went out the industry for a couple of years. If you don't mind diving into some of the other endeavors that you've had an experience in.
Well, when I say out, sort of broadly still in media, when I went after ETV, I went to Europe, and I was based in London representing a company called TV Africa. It was a Pan-African TV network. We had four different TV feeds into 23 countries in Africa, and we supplied TV content.
Okay.
Up to 20 hours a day. So you might be a TV station in Nigeria and you can't afford content, so we supplied the content and the programming for you.
Okay.
And in return, we got two ad breaks an hour for us, which we sold Pan-Africa and regional advertising on, and they would have two local ad breaks for themselves. So they got advertising, they got content. It was a great mix. So that was me being based in London and having to run around Europe and see big brands and customers who advertise in sub-Saharan Africa. And that whole job was about education. Educating that there is a market in sub-Saharan Africa. People, you know, the economies are growing. There's an opportunity there for you. So that was very interesting.
Had fun.
Whether going into French companies in Paris, you know, where their English is not so good, and just presenting to them. You know, to go. I even went to Puma shoes in Austria at the time, and Red Bull. So I went to see even Pirelli tires in Milan, because they had a base in sub-Saharan Africa. So I went to see them at pitch. So it was fun, but exhausting.
Exhausting.
I could never do it now. Couldn't have done it now with kids and things. It was BC before children.
Before children.
You know?
So we've got a nice prefix at work as well, BBC. Some of our staff members are born before computers. So we struggle on some of the systems.
Well, I was born before computers. My first job at that print company in London, the Classic Car Magazine, it taught us how to use computers, and it was DOS, and it was, you know, click, 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 you know. It was old school. It was so old school. So I remember learning how to type ASDFJKL. You know, I still remember that. It's about all I remember.
and having the experience of Pirelli, customers in France, obviously customers in South Africa, who are the toughest negotiators?
Oh, the toughest I found were actually the French.
Really?
Yeah. One of our big brands there was Total Energies.
Yes.
Then they were called Total Fina Elf. And we had the Cup of Nations rights for Sub-Saharan Africa, and we had the World Cup TV rights for Sub-Saharan Africa back then. And they were sponsors. But the negotiation with, you know, and I'm not going to upset any French people here, but very bureaucratic and very demanding, and it's tough. And I've had that as well in the past with one of our TV brands that we represented a couple of years back at MediaMark. The French are hard negotiators. They're tough and bureaucratic. You know, Germans are, but you know, the French to me were the toughest.
The toughest. Yeah, interesting. I wouldn't have called them. No.
Because the rest, you can kind of get across and see where the angles are, and you can understand each other, but they were hard.
Beautiful.
I was surprised. Yeah.
So, I want to ask this question from two angles. Rather than saying, you know, failures in your career, because obviously you've hit some stumbling blocks that perhaps set you back a little bit, like, oh, I know, this wasn't a good experience, but I've learned from it. But as a phenomenal leader, and you are a lion amongst lions, so you're a leader of leaders. What, in your opinion, stunts a leader's growth potential? Because I'll give you my perspective. In our company, we're a growing company. We're almost on 270 people.
Sure.
Like one thing that I've seen is that the moment financially people get rewarded very well, it's tough for me to keep them in their lane, and that's hard work. Then I become an HR master after hours. Like my wife knows, from 17 until 9, I'm like, please don't buy a GTI. Please, you're not ready for a GTI yet. So that's what I've seen. But in your opinion, you've obviously dealt with much bigger corporations. What is the tendency that people should look out for? Like, if this happens, you catch yourself because we've heard it here on the channel. What do you think is a negative in a leadership's growth?
I think ego is probably the one thing I'd say. It goes through your head, and you go, "I'm so important." You know, self-importance. You know, you can't let that get to your head ever. You know, you always got to be humble. I think humility is critical. You got to show some vulnerability. You got to be authentic. You know, when I've seen, you know, people did very well, have done well in the industry, and then they've sort of imploded. It's gone to their head. They've grown quickly. It's all about me. And then they'll disappear into the you know, horizon. But you know, keep guarding against ego. Don't think you're better than anyone else, ever. You know, you have to be able to talk to the cleaner in your company and know her name and appreciate her. Every single person is important because everyone's a leader in their own way.
Yes.
That cleaner may be a leader in their own community back home.
Yes.
You know, so how dare you think that you're better than them? So that to me is critical. And sometimes young leaders who do very well very quickly and are successful and make money by the age of sort of 30, they haven't learned those things. They haven't learned humility. It's all about me. Look at me, you know, and I'm so cool. And they fall hard sometimes.
Yes.
I mean, I've seen that with a youngster at SABC. He did very well. He was very successful, made a lot of money. And the next year he didn't. By then he was on drugs and things and eventually lost his life.
Wow.
So I've seen that. That's very sad. And I had to go down to speak to his parents. But that's success too quickly, and no one coaching and guiding you. You know, one of the things I picked up in my company, some people said, wow, you come in and say hi to us in the morning and you know us. And I was like, well, isn't that normal? Apparently that hasn't always been normal for leaders in the past. You know, they just, you know, only say hello to certain people and go straight to the office, you know, and just bring them my coffee. But I think humility is critical. And also that leadership, there's, you need to inspire sometimes, you need to drive sometimes, you need to be the, get in touch with people, almost the fund guy, but also you got to be the king sometimes. It depends. There's different roles you play at different times and where different needs are, different caps. And every single individual is also different in the company. You don't tar people with the same brush. You know, everyone is different. You need to know what works for this person, what works for that person.
Yeah. People are driven by different things.
Exactly.
What I've experienced. And some people can't be driven by competition just because Johnny can. You know, I can drive Johnny by saying, listen, Yaku is 2 cars ahead of you and you only have 10 days. Like, I can't believe Yaku's ahead of you. It's never happened before. And I know in 3 or 4 days, Johnny's going to be 10 cars ahead of Yaku. But if I say that to a different individual, it will discourage him. So it's leadership is so hard.
Totally. So it's getting to know people individually, getting to know what their hot buttons are, their triggers are, the kind of person they are, their backgrounds. What is their purpose? Why are they getting up every day? What are they trying to achieve in their lives? That's critical. And when you understand their purpose and what they're trying to achieve, you can help them get there. I think that's really important.
And that's the leader's job.
Yeah.
And along the way, for example, the gentleman with the GTI, where I'm like, please, you don't buy the GTI. How do you manage that ego at the point when the person is hot? You know, I'm the next best thing. And you mentioned off camera that sometimes your emotions are making the decision rather than your thought process. Your decision making happens in your heart and not in your brain.
Especially when you're younger.
When you're younger. If your ID number starts with a 9, it's hard to lead you.
Yeah, absolutely.
So how do you process that with a person? And I think the next 2 or 3 minutes, it could be a book. I'm so keen to hear it.
Well, that's the toughest thing. I think for a lot of us, you know, youngsters come in your organization and you don't understand how they think or what motivates them and the emotions make them do things. And it's been traditional, no, this is the way things are done. Listen to the way we do things. And then you get this class of staff that you hear about in some of your surveys that are just disengaged. And the old school would be to say they're disengaged, they must just be fired. They're disengaged because you're not understanding what their needs are and you're not empowering them and getting to understand them at every level. So in a situation like you're mentioning over there, it's to say, let me get to understand what you're all about, what your dreams are, why you're motivated to do X, Y, and Z, and then try to put yourself back in that space when you were their age. And just as I said, try appeal to the intellect. So emotional, yes, I agree with you. I also want that GTI. Because I had a GTI 16 valve once upon a time. It was the best thing I ever had when I was 72. Loved that car. Spent a fortune at Steve's Auto Clinic, you know, and broke down the middle of the Free State. The flange broke, but that's another story. So I spent money and then I couldn't afford to fix these things.
But you had the GTI.
But I had it. But then you start saying, what does it mean? And do you know how much this thing costs? And you know, people don't respect you just for your car. If they're mad about you and the girls chase you for your car, do you really want to be those kind of girls?
You need the guns.
And the, and the gun. You need the guns. You know, the little city golf and the guns, you should be good enough. You know, you don't want those girls who want the fancy car. Anyway, you'll learn in later time. But it's just it's really sitting down and getting to know people and just appealing and helping them get there on their own. Not telling them, just saying, have you thought about this? Have you thought about this? Have you thought about that? Based on my experience, when I was your age, these are the things that happened to me. And yes, you win the lottery or whatever, great, good for you. But if you haven't, you know, you're taking this car and a massive residual and all those things, you're going to be hurting in a few years' time. Yeah. What if you suddenly need to sell that car in 3 years' time? You can't. You still got this big residual to pay off. So be careful. So think ahead.
You know, not directly opposing the opinion. No, that's a that's a horrible idea. Sure. Don't do it. rather appeal to the intellect and let that person come up with the idea that this is a bad idea through questions.
Yeah, I think that's the way one deals with one's own children sometimes. I mean, having teenage children, you say, no, this is not the way. They don't listen anyway. All right? So you just sometimes got to try other ways of getting there. But they're teenagers, they still don't listen anyway. So that's a bad example. Teenagers, especially their own children, they don't listen. So they'll listen one day when they're out of school. Yeah, hopefully.
I'm sure they will, sir. And going to the children, it takes a village to raise a man. It takes a global village to raise a brilliant man like you. If you were, I know there's more than three, but the three people that come to mind that were most influential in your life and perhaps course correcting you a little bit, I'm headed in this direction after this specific person touched me. I course corrected and I headed into a different direction. Who are those people for you and how did those people influence your life?
I think the obvious one for me personally would be my late mother. You know, I was the only child from the first marriage, and my mother always inspired me with confidence to be able to do anything, and she was very outspoken. I think that's where I got some of my outspokenness from. A major, one hell of a temper as well, which is the scary bit. But she always said,
"Go for it. I want to get back onto that.
Go for it. Do what you need to do. Don't let anything stop you. You can do it. You can achieve anything you want, my son." And that was, I think that's the one thing. It gives you the confidence to go forward in life.
Okay.
And then from there, you know, no matter what, sometimes I had, you know, pitfalls and things throughout life. It was always, don't worry, but you're going to get back up on your feet. You're going to keep going. So keep inspiring hope. She was brilliant that way. Then the other person to me is my wife. You know, I've been married sort of 22 years.
We Congratulations,
met,
sir.
You know, in November. And she's always, you know, they always say, you know, strong woman behind you. And absolutely, she's allowed me to follow my career path. Been always very, very supportive and been an amazing advisor and mentor and supported me in every way. I think that is critical, someone like that. So no matter what you come home to, and sometimes you come home and you know, you take out the frustrations at home, you kick the cat and those sort of things.
You also kick the cat? I thought I was the only one.
But, you know, she's been strong and she's super. She's got a PhD, you know, she's a super intellectual, an amazing woman in every single way and calm and, you know, and has managed to deal with all my nonsense over the years. And, you know, this industry's a lot of glamour and parties and back in the day. And sometimes, you know, you kind of just want to calm down a bit. So my wife's been, without doubt, the next most important person, without a doubt, throughout my life. And then a gentleman called Quinton Green, who was my boss at ETV. Because I was GM sales. He came in, he was head of SABC at one stage. He's an amazing man. He came in as chief commercial officer at ETV. And just the way he led, the way he inspired, the humility, he took me with him into TV Africa, this Pan-African TV group, where I ended up being 2 years in London. You know, I could have gone, had a safe job, but I always went for the more entrepreneurial, more exciting things. And Quinton was humble and down to earth, but firm, and someone you could always speak to. And that is, a lot of my leadership learnings have come from someone like Quinton as well.
Beautiful.
You know, just how to lead, how to be one with the people, as it were, and inspire and give of all your knowledge and wisdom. And he was amazing in that way for me as well.
A lot of people don't realize that. I believe there's three type of mentors. The first mentor is somebody that has read a lot of books. Typically, that's the lowest level of mentor. Yeah. So if you go and subscribe to a lecture at a university from a... And I'm not beating anybody. This is my opinion. You know, somebody that teaches you how to run a business but has never ran a business, you know, will give you the theory behind running a business. Yeah. There's marketing, there's accounting, there's staff, there's legal, there's all these departments that need to be pulled together and work together. The second one is somebody that has studied and or perhaps has worked with somebody that's a great leader. You can learn from that person, I believe, more than the theoretical person. And then there's the third one that's a trifecta, and that's why you called out his name, because you have a living experience running with him and looking at what he does every day and just, you know, taking notes and this is amazing.
That's still the best. And just another, you know, in just terms of learning about humility as well, that all comes through. So you need, as you said, you can learn everything from a book, from YouTube, as I was telling you.
Beautiful.
But you need someone that you can follow and learn from and ask questions, and someone that can give you advice and someone can be a mentor. We all need that so-called gray beard that you follow. Find a gray beard to like latch onto and learn from.
And I believe I've got, you know, two or three people like that in my life, and somebody that can kick your ass.
Yeah. No, yeah. Be honest with you. Don't
kick your ass. Like, listen, you screwed up. own it. This is not the right way to handle things. Own it. Here's how we move forward from this. Boom, 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 boom.
I think the owning it is so important. People often don't want to do that. You know, take accountability, own it. And even when you speak to people, you know, you say to them, did a great job on this. And the words you use, not but you could have done better. I always use the word and. And you could improve it even more if you did this.
Yeah.
That's how you say it as well. To get that across. But you have to be, you got to be honest with people and have to take it on the chin. Because you're not, it's not personal. This is to make you a better person.
Yeah. And that and just lands softly, but it lands. Oh, it lands.
Exactly. So it was and, not but.
I love it. I've definitely mental ticked it in my mind. I'm going to use it today.
Cool.
So to be in the position that you currently are, and I'm going to say it openly, you have to have an ego. A leader has to have an ego. If you don't have an ego, you can't comprehend that I'm going to wake up today, I'm going to lead multiple companies, multiple personalities. Mm. You know, you've got the legend who is Deirdre King. You've got all these people that are reporting into you. You've got an ego. And this is a question not from the team, from me. How do you manage your state? So for example, a lot of younger entrepreneurs, younger leaders can't manage the state. I know I'm one of them. So it's a very selfish question. I come out of a sales meeting, you know, we aren't hitting the numbers. Somewhere along the line, we're making mistakes. It's a tough meeting. I'm emotional. I'm trying to deal with it as best I can.
Yeah.
And I walk into a marketing meeting where, you know, people have created content. And how do you manage your state not to bring the energy that you leave with in the first room to the second room? Because if you mess up, oh man, the effect on the second room, it's hard to manage that. How do you do it, sir?
Yeah, I think the first thing I just want to say is Deirdre doesn't report into me.
Okay.
Because the Kisa Media radio stations run as separate entities alongside, you know. And myself and Deirdre's boss, we sit in the Kisa Media level there. But we work together like this.
Yes.
So we work, we learn a lot from each other. We compare notes a lot. So it's important to know that. But I think that obviously we all have egos. That's important. But I think the energy you bring into a room. And there will be times I've got to hold myself back because I can get frustrated sometimes. I like excellence. I don't like, you know, half jobs or mediocrity at all. It could come in whether it's marketing or whether there's a spelling mistake on a social post. The guys know that I'll be the first one to go, what's going on? And I question things, but I always praise publicly, and reprimand privately. So I won't make it a big thing.
So praise publicly
and reprimand privately. So it's a one-on-one, but it's not a reprimand even. So listen, I noticed this. That could have been done better. Why was it done like this? How can we fix it? How did you get there? Who did this? Let's fix it. You know, I won't do it. Sometimes people go, well, you didn't say anything to them. Why aren't you reprimanding us? Well, how do you know I'm not? It's not about that, you know. But the ego, sometimes you want to just say, you know, say how, what heck were you thinking?
Just shake somebody. But, I want to shake people sometimes.
And often that's what you just got to take a breath. And whether it's saying something or even writing an email, I always say don't do it with emotion.
Yes.
Stand back, you know, in leadership and think about it first and say it the right way. Also, a great leader is a better listener. You listen well. Two ears, one mouth, as I always said in sales back in the day. And it works in life. Listen and listen to respond properly. Don't listen to defend yourself.
Don't have a loaded answer that you're ready to
Waiting. You're waiting. You're listening to defend, to fight back. No, you're listening to learn, and you listen, and you can take your time when you answer these things or get involved or make the next move. I think that's when it comes with maturity. Because the younger me would have, you know,
thrown chairs around,
kicked down the table, whatever, and you know, the anger comes out. You know, think it's good, but it's actually not. You actually lose authority and respect when you do that straight away. So always be calm to me.
I received great advice from a mentor of mine, and maybe it makes sense to you. So he leads a team of 30,000 salespeople in America. And you know, also a young man like you. And I said to him, sir, you know, I came out of a I'm fortunate enough to spend 90 minutes with him on Zoom twice a month, and you know, processing current problems and like, this is what's coming. I told you it's coming. And then, you know, I'm like, no, it's not coming. And then something hits me. It's like, I told you it's coming. Anyway, and I ask you because it happened to me. You know, I come out of a horrible sales meeting where, you know, I've lost my temper. I'm like, guys, come on. You know, that emotion builds. I'm like, oh, I can't believe this. I don't mind new mistakes, but the same old mistakes, And he says to me, Bobby, with that American accent, I always have one person sitting on this shoulder and another one here. And he said, and it will forever stay with me. If you lose your temper, then this person says, you know, I told you we're not going to make the next level. I told you. You're not going to make it because you can't control yourself. Yeah. And the other one says, we'll see. Maybe I can gain control of my temper and make it to the next level. So similar to what you said, control your emotions and rather come from a place of let's work around it rather than bash you.
And if you let your emotions out and there's anger and the old school, you know, sales management, where we're a lot more top down, do it or else. And when you do that, people keep quiet. They don't say anything. So they either don't express what's going on, you don't really know what's really happening, or they just leave, you know, the company, or the top performers sometimes leave. You know, so it's better to manage that and let people feel that they're still in a safe space, they can come to you and talk about what's going on in their lives. And if they fail, then say why they fail. How are we going to learn from this? Yeah. Don't beat them up about it, because, you know, we have to fail to get better. You know, and I think in legacy thinking, legacy companies, it's got to be perfect or don't do it at all. Yeah. You're just trying to get perfect. And
there's no such thing.
Perfection doesn't exist, and I myself have been very much part of that way of thinking in the past. And I think my digital years, I learned to be, you know, was always get things done, just move fast, you know, learn, iterate, be agile. We've basically digitized our whole company at MediaMarkt now. We've got systems from beginning to end, between the stations, between us, our clients, and that whole digitization workflow improvement project. The biggest thing we learned was how to be more agile, we learned a whole new way of thinking. So it's taught us how to be agile. It's not just a system, you know, whole change management. And that's been the biggest change for MediaMarkt over the last 2 years or so. It's just agility, changing, thinking, iterating, always thinking, where can I improve? Not thinking that's the way it's done. You know, don't change from there.
It's very tough on your point, because there's access to so much information and there's so much, I mean, our world is, I heard a great quote the other day, our world is the fastest it's ever been today.
Oh, that's true.
And here's the kicker, it will never be this slow again.
Terrifying.
Terrifying, yeah. So how does one as a leader, and you do stand on top of the mountain, but you know, doing this, pulling everybody up, how does one, and another, this is a selfish question, it's my question, how does one stop and say, okay, I'm just getting all this information, I'm reading the books, I'm listening to podcasts, I'm doing a course here, I'm taking in, how does one say, okay, stop, now you have to deploy, you know, stop, block out, or does that process work differently for you as a leader?
I think you have to be intentional about making time to impart knowledge and discuss and to mentor people. Because if you don't, it will never happen, because things are always happening. There's always something happening, some crisis, something you've got to deal with. So you're not ever, you can get to a point where you never actually give information back. I mean, I was asked to do a lecture to WITS students about 2-3 weeks ago, because we're very involved in the WITS Radio Academy. So we students from all sorts of radio stations. There's even one from an Anglo-American mine, where they have a radio station on the mine, and they come through and we help lecture. So I gave a talk to all these students. It was the most amazing thing. I remembered what a good feeling it is to impart information and to give back wisdom that I've gained over the years, and to learn from them as well.
Yes.
So, you know, I try with the new guys joining the company to sit down around the table and learn from them and chat to them and pick up information. Because when you really ask people, you know, in maybe the most junior positions for opinions, I'm always amazed the knowledge that comes out. There's so much knowledge sitting over there. But you have to be intentional about finding these gaps, make time to do it. You know, intentional leadership, otherwise stuff happens. And we have to always focus on the urgent, not the important. I mean, the important, not the urgent.
Not the urgent, there we go.
Because urgent takes up all your time. So you always got to think, it's urgent, but is it important as well? Wow. Or can I push it out? Right to the extent of making time in my calendar, which my time in this busy world, saying, don't just put everything in my calendar, you know, to Nicolette, my PA. What's really important right now? Is that really important? Does it have to be in my calendar? Do I have to be in every single meeting? You know, do I have to? Do I really need to? There's someone else in that meeting. So I'm trying to intentionally, and I think a lot of us in the leadership team are trying to intentionally make time to do the right things right and spend time where it's important, because that's all we have is time.
Yes.
And this world's getting faster and faster. It's stand back a bit. And some things aren't that important at all. Just push them away.
And focus on the important rather than the urgent.
And the important stuff is in being in touch with your people and our people and guiding them and mentoring them and inspiring them and learning from them and helping them and assisting them and taking all the cholesterol away so they can do their jobs a lot better and a lot smoother. That to me is a critical part of a leader's job. Help people get their jobs done the most efficient way possible, which then helps our clients, you know, get the best results and the best service.
From your people, beautiful. I think everybody should rewind to the beginning of the interview and start it again. But most importantly, the last 2-3 minutes, I'm getting goosebumps. Focus on the important, not the urgent. Not the urgent, because there will always be something that's urgent. There's a fire somewhere.
Always. And that was COVID times. You were just in that surgery there, just stemming the blood flow.
Yeah.
You have to stand back and you know, raise above and see what's really going on.
Yeah. That way you don't need to be a firefighter. You can actually build fire stations.
Exactly. That's a great analogy.
Yeah.
It's a great analogy.
Beautiful. So, I'm always fascinated with, if I picture you on a Sunday and you don't have anything to do, it's just you and the family, or maybe the odd occasion, it's just you by yourself. What do you do with yourself on a Sunday? Like, what's a perfect day for you? Are you jogging? Are you watching Netflix? Like, how does a leader of your caliber spend his free time?
Yeah, there's the ideals, and there's things like, you know, I need to get back in the gym and a few of those things. But I think a good Sunday, the weather's great. Get up, you know, make a good breakfast. I'll make breakfast most morning, because my son likes a certain kind of breakfast. It has to be omelets, done this way, not that way. So make him breakfast. Every morning is the same, and then I'll make myself and my wife as well. My daughter likes to do her own thing. Sunday morning, I'll make breakfast. Then possibly just go for a walk. You know, there's the Westcliff steps in Joburg, which are really steep steps. And people running up and down, training for Kilimanjaro. Just like go a few walks up and down there with my wife to get a bit of fitness, and then I'm stiff for the rest of the week in my calf muscles. But it's just, and it's the time to talk and engage. So you're walking and you're exercising, but you're just talking and engaging and having quality time. That to me is so, so important.
Where's your phone?
You know?
Where's your phone at that time of the morning on a Sunday?
It's probably charging somewhere, you know.
So it's not with you?
It's only with me when I'm walking, because I'm seeing how many steps I've done. Okay, it's got the health thing on it, so it'll check the steps.
Okay.
Only reason, but I'm not busy checking.
You're not engaged.
Social media. And I've had to be intentional about that as well. Because I think in the past, you know, you get up, phone, check phone, social media. It sucks you into a vortex.
Consumes you.
You know, and I think during that whole awful COVID period, we all got sucked into the vortex of opinions and things. And I've intentionally stood back from it, because it can be destructive. You know, that's not the world. That's not the world. The most important thing is engaging with your partner, your wife, your children.
The 2 feet in front of you.
Yeah, that your children, and then hopefully going for a walk in the afternoon with the dogs in the park in Delta Park or in Marentia Park there, and then going for a really nice lunch, you know, ideally the whole family, if not just my wife, myself, great lunch, good glass of wine. It's simple stuff.
It's just chill.
You know, and then watch some Netflix in the evening, you know, watching a really great one, Barbarians now, season 2.
Good.
Brilliant, you know. Okay. The sort of Germanic tribes who fought the Romans. Brilliant. Just, it takes your mind off everything. It's based on facts. And I like a bit of history with a bit of fact involved. So it's chill. It's relaxation time. And then do a bit of, to me, I love doing a bit of gardening.
Gardening.
It's my way of taking things, You know, I think I learned that as a kid. When exam time came, I was the best gardener. Anything not to study for exams.
You've got the green hand, the green fingers,
yeah.
Everything grows. I don't
know. The plants in the house always tend to have to be replaced every year. I don't know why they don't live. I think overwater, underwater. But it's fun, it's relaxing, and it gives me pleasure.
Got you.
You know, sometimes I have to say to the kids, we have a garden, enjoy it. I'm not the only one to walk around the garden and enjoy it.
Beautiful. Now, we've got a landmines question. And perhaps over the, you've been very, very calculated in your career. Obviously, you've made some mistakes and you've had some pushback that you've had to overcome and endure. But in your opinion, what are the sort of biggest landmines that one should look for in your industry, which is marketing and radio? And what are some evergreen landmines that you can give us the GPS addresses on so that we can plot them and say, don't step on these landmines, they hurt. Perhaps one or two that you've stepped on that you feel like, wow, that was anger.
Yeah, I think the one landmine, and I can say because it's our state broadcaster, was probably the SABC. I came back from TV Africa in Europe. I came back to the country, and one of my ex-bosses, Peter Mitlara, the late Peter Mitlara, he was deputy CEO of APSA, and he passed away from COVID last year. But he was head of Prime Media Broadcasting by that stage. And then he moved across to head up SABC. And, you know, he had met with him, and he said, come in and run the radio agency's team. All sort of 16, 17 radio stations, which was amazing. And we restructured, and that's where I met Nick Grubb, who was head of programming for 5FM, who's Deirdre's boss, for example.
Yes.
I remember the one time I had literally a shouting match with my boss, the GM, and it wasn't pleasant in the boardroom because he was like, you know, why are you supporting this particular account executive of yours? And I was like, because he's done nothing wrong and I will support him to the end. And then I was, you know, in a shouting across the table. I wasn't proud of that moment. But that's what it brought out of me. You know, I even made a hole in a door once over there.
Really?
Because I was accused.
I was accused
of terrible things by one manager there. I won't even mention what I was accused of there. And I went to his office, I told him what I thought of him. I punched a hole in his door, and they all backed off then. And so that was a landmine. I would never want to go back. And they're wonderful individuals in the SABC. And I even knew Nyes with the EFF, Dali.
Yes.
You know, Dali Mpofu was head of SABC for a short while. I knew him from Wits University days, before
back
his EFF days. And I went to see him the once there, and then suddenly my GM was like, how dare you see him? Whose side are you on, mine or Dali's? I was like, I'm on the client's side. I was like, the client, who's that?
Who's that?
Yeah, so that
is
was...
Is the client important?
So I learned how not to do things. I'd had my first child, my second child was born. You know, money wasn't coming in. I had to sell my house. It was a really tough time. But I also learned, you know, how to manage, I think, my own, you know, emotions, and understood where I didn't want to work and understood how to treat people. That's whatever they did, the opposite, you know, is a way to do things. And also that I stood up for myself. Because you can go along with the flow and just melt in. That wasn't me. You know, if I believe in something, I'll stand up for my people and it doesn't matter what.
And learning how not to do things is critical.
Part of it.
I was blessed. Not at the time, it felt like, wow, how did I end up here? I was blessed. You know, I was still in high school when I started selling cars for a gentleman. And he was a very nice guy. He's a decent guy, very friendly, but had a vicious drinking problem.
Oh.
And I saw, you know, through working with him for 2 years, what not to do in business, because I had the living experience of what it does in terms of stockholding and how that company ran into the ground. So I stopped drinking. I don't drink any alcohol, don't smoke cigarettes. So learning what not to do there has really helped me. And you know, I was able to adjust and do things differently.
I think you need to go through some bad patches like that. You know, I worked for a company in the UK, a small print company. I did publication for the video and film industry and owner run. And I remember one day watching this owner hit, literally fist one of my fellow sales guy in the face.
I thought our sales team was quite enthusiastic.
So,
wow.
So yeah, that also left there the same day, left them with the company car, because those that want the company car. So I've been through the top, the small and the large. I've been through big corporate, small ones. But you learn from every single time you go anywhere, you learn.
Yeah.
You know, so I don't see anything as a failure. I see everything as a place to learn. You know, could have done things better. We could have made different decisions. but it's all part of who we are and all the learnings that we have. You know, the one thing I think is, you know, if I'd known back at school, friends of mine went straight into sort of, you know, financial, you know, side of things, and they're bankers and things, and they made fortunes in money. But I think I would have been bored.
Yeah, the numbers, it's like the Matrix eventually.
You know, yes, they made the money, but oh no, the boredom, I couldn't have done that.
I actually want to share a company story with you. Yeah. The way that we sort out, you know, indifferences in the sales, force is arm wrestling. So you got the deal first. No, I got the deal first. Okay, cool. There's the table when it takes the deal. So if you're not smart or quick, you have to be strong in our company. So if you're strong, you can now and then steal a few deals.
We have a deal. We couldn't do that where we work. We're quite funny with Melody's team arm wrestling over
I can imagine Melody and Payo.
Arm wrestling there. Melody will win every time. I mean, I work with Melody back in 702 days.
She's
you know.
Tough.
I got her into MediaMarkt to run Jacaranda's sales team 15 years ago when I was there, because I was group sales director back then. I left in 2010 and I came back 10 years later. And it's amazing to come back and see that she's still pumping at all cylinders, runs an amazing team. They excel, they're all brilliant.
Melody.
And it's the same people are there most, so they stayed with her, which is a testament to
her leadership. Yes. So in my mind, you know, when I close my eyes, Bobby, you are a phenomenal negotiator. Yeah. So, you know, my experience with her, she's a lovely woman. I love her to bits. I said, Melody, me and you should have a prize discussion in person, because I want to read body language. I know the angles. I know how to put the pressure. So Melody, at one or other stage, has some French influence. I just want to put that on camera. She definitely does. So somewhere in the grandparents or great-grandparents were from France.
She's a great negotiator. She was our number one person, the direct sales team at 702 back in the old days when Stan Katz was running.
No doubt.
And she hasn't changed. She knows her stuff. She believes in her people. She'll go into get in the trenches with them. You know, she's amazing.
Over the years, you've worked with phenomenal, great leaders. What are some of the scenarios that perhaps come to mind that you could share? Okay, this is what I've picked up here. I really admired this. I brought it into my arsenal of leadership skills. If you can mention one or two or three leaders that you've had the opportunity to work with that you've learned from. I'm sure there's...
Well, I think the one is obviously Quentin Green that I mentioned. He came in and became COO of TV Africa. I learned from a ton from him. Then I think, you know, going even back before then, he wasn't directly, he ran the whole of 702 before, and then became Prime Media Broadcasting, and he helped them acquire 947. This is Stan Katz, who was a DJ and a marketer and ran the business. And he got very involved with sales. He's written actually a book about, you know, selling radio and what it means. He's even showed me where he's got my name in there. You know, he still lectures on that. He's on a small radio station. So I learned a ton from him, just, you know, understanding the passion of what radio is all about, understanding what it does for clients, how it grows their businesses, and just the excitement of the industry. You know, someone like him taught me a ton, which I've always tried to take through. The problem is when you mention his name to the youngsters that I work with, they go, Stan who? And that's the thing, he's a legend.
Unfortunately.
Still is a legend, but the youngsters don't know that. So you've got to bring them the history of where radio came from. I mean, I've come back to radio three times in my life, I think about it. So Stan is definitely one. Quinton is definitely someone I rate really, really highly. And then it's just people I've worked with, I think, that have made a difference in my life. You know, there's someone I work with, Dave Kelly, as well, on TV Africa, and I worked with him about 4 years ago back in the TV industry in Africa. And he ran an agency back in the day, a big ad agency. And just, again, you know, human, authentic, a great guy, willing to always give advice, and kind. I think leaders that resonate with me personally are kind leaders. They're firm, but there's a kindness. They're always kind. They want the best for you. It's not about them. It's not about their ego.
Yeah.
And they're fair. They're fair. If you're unfair, you're out of my books completely.
Yeah. Kind, for the longest time, I always thought a kind person is a weak person. Mm.
That was how we all grew up thinking, right?
But a kind person is so strong because, as you say, as long as it's fair.
Yeah.
We've had a conversation around this a couple of months ago. Look, I feel that you need to pay more attention here. Mm-hmm. And if it continuously happens, then perhaps, you know, this is not your path. And that's very strong. Instead of
you do it in a very kind way, in a firm way, and you get a lot more out of people that way. People go the extra mile for you. As I said, people will always remember how you made them feel, not what you did. How did you make them feel? And that's what they take away with them. And also when they leave a company, and they'll talk about where they've come from, if it was a great experience or a great experience, say, working with me in the leadership role, people come back, and the people also spread that knowledge in the industry. People say, I want to go work with Wayne.
You create a reputation, you know? Or an enemy.
Yeah, or an enemy, exactly. And your reputation, you don't own your reputation, everyone else owns it. So your reputation is really, really important.
And you don't own it.
You don't own it.
Wow.
You can't, you know, only think about what do people think of me, because I think of the younger me would have been, what are people thinking of me, you know? Now it's like, I am who I am. I think, you know, if you like me, you like me. If you don't, you don't. But this is who I am, and this is, I'm authentic. And if you like the reputation that I've put out there, and I, you know, then you'll find your way to me.
Yeah. If you don't, more power to you. All the best.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly.
Beautiful. What is the best advice that you've ever received that landed as soft as snow and it made sense? Boom.
I think it's something which I probably only really picked up in the last decade. It's the most simple one. And, you know, working in the digital space when these companies are a lot more innocent, because we used to represent Facebook for Africa advertising and LinkedIn and these big brands at a previous company. And
they were a lot more innocent. I love that you said that, yes.
Different time. That whole time was a lot more about better done than perfect. And the old me would have been, it's got to be perfect, got to get it done. And you go crazy trying to get this thing perfect before you launch it or do anything. And you beat yourself up and you don't get anything done then. You procrastinate because you want to make it perfect. And the whole philosophy of these digital companies back in the day when they were more gentle and they weren't corporate and they weren't just money, 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 was all around better done than perfect. And that's, you know, it's just cross the line. Just start iterating. You can always tweak and iterate along the way, and it's written in pencil. But the better done than perfect is something that's worked for me. And it's just get things done. We'll make it perfect along the way. Nothing's perfect. There's no winning. You're always trying to make things better and trying to level up. Level up, level up, get better. And I will say to guys, today just try to be better than you were yesterday. And I think the better done than perfect, though, sums it up for me. Just get it done.
I love it.
You know?
And you know, that's an evergreen strategy. You can deploy it in your life. I always say to my team, we're busy building a system. And the head developer, I said to him, wow, we came up with a terrible system that works. But now we're going to be able to give you feedback, constant feedback, and we're going to take a terrible system and make it phenomenal. It will never be perfect because you're right. If for the longest time I thought, let's hold out on building the system, let's make it perfect. But by the time it's perfect in your realm of what perfection is, it's already old.
Exactly, exactly. I mean, we are, as leaders, you're managing systems, right?
Yeah.
And when we launched this whole workflow rebuild at MediaMark, we put money aside. We got this top digital company, digital, you know, workflow digitization company, DYDX. And as we started the project, then COVID hit. And suddenly we're burning R1 million a month. I was like, put everything on hold.
Wow.
And don't worry, this will be 3-4 months and it'll all be over. And of course, it wasn't. So we're like, 4 or 5 months later, I said, let's just start this project. We haven't got the money, we have to do it. So we got in there, we did it. It's been 2 years later and we're 95% of the way there. It's changed the whole culture of the company. It's been a change management thing as well. It's been the first time the company's ever done a full workflow rebuild from beginning to end ever. There've been little bits done in different departments, but you're an organism, you're a system. You have to do the whole company. Yes. By doing that, you find where all the challenges are, where the, as I call, cholesterol is, the inefficiencies are, and we've cleaned that up.
Accountability. Wow,
you can
that's a big thing.
We have a system where you can hold every single person accountable. Everything goes into the system. You know, and it makes it makes all the difference. But it's changed. It's been amazing for our company. But we could have sat back and not been, you know, kept waiting for the right time and trying to make it perfect and get the experts in, get it done, take the pain, and now it's
improve.
I mean, we've come out a much better company post-COVID. You know, leaner, more agile, more efficient, you know, better able to make decisions quicker on the fly.
Because you've got the data at hand, and data doesn't lie. And,
exactly.
And on the accountability part, we're experiencing a similar shift in our company. And accountability is a beautiful thing. You know, accountability is lift your hand and be counted. So even in a sales environment, if you have access to the data and you see I'm not making my target, but we go and do a deep dive in your data, which doesn't lie, but your closing ratio is 15% below what it should be. Here's training on how to actually present an offer to purchase to a customer. Boom, sales go up because data doesn't lie.
Exactly. You can pick up the strike rates, you know.
Yes.
In RBM, we look at retention of business. We look at, you know, growth on business. We look at new business. We look at the churn. You look at the yield as well. And someone's just selling by just discounting. That's not selling, right?
Yes.
Not, you need to be adding value to your clients.
Well, now
so
I
you look
see
at all
where,
those things.
Now I see where Melody gets it from. So, Melody,
beautiful. Always add value, you know.
Yes,
so
yes.
That's
when the value exceeds the price, the customer buys.
Exactly, and people. If you otherwise just commoditize what you're doing. It's just about the number. It's a race to the bottom. It's not the way you run a business.
Yes, sir. Agree.
You know.
Wow. Hand on heart. I've met thousands of people. This last hour that we've spent together has been one of my favorites in my entire life. I'm really privileged and honored. This has been my favorite interview so far that I've done.
Thank you so much. I've been loving it. It's fantastic, this, because we don't often get a chance to do this, right?
And
you know, it's so special to be able to do this with you.
And you know, we are hopefully, if I've done a good enough job, and I know you have. So, you know, ignore me. Listen to the expert. You know, this is evergreen knowledge that's passed down for free. That you can actually, you can take the stuff that you've taught us and deploy it right now, and it will work, and it will drive a team better. It will just create a company culture of competition and growth.
Absolutely.
So if you were to give your one of your best, obviously it's off the cuff, best advice that you could give young people that are going into a marketing career or into any career, because everything in life, I believe, is selling. I sold the idea to my wife that, you know, there's the ring, proof. I'm a great salesman. I've got a beautiful wife. You know, I sold her this life that when you close your eyes, babe, you know, this is what we're going to go through. This is where we're going to live. This is where our kids will go to school. So everything is selling.
Yeah, so agree.
What is the one evergreen advice that you can give people?
Well, if you're thinking of going to a particular industry, let's say it is media, marketing, and advertising, sales, then try job shadow someone. Try say, you know, say, I know you in this industry. Can I just spend a week with you? Just seeing what you do and how you do it. See, to get a feel if you actually enjoy it or not. You know, when we get interns and vets, we put them in different departments to get a feel, because you don't know from the outside. Try get a feel. I promise you, people will give you a chance. If someone, you know, contacts me and says, I really want to get a feel. Can I just pop into your company, spend a few days in your company, see how you do things? Just, I'll say, come, get a feel. And if you feel that passion, then the next step is to make sure that you then go and get some skills in terms of also something, learn some stuff. There's certificates. First of all, online certificates, they're all pretty much free.
Yes.
Google certificates, LinkedIn Learning, Facebook Blueprint, and digital marketing. There's Vega, there's a AAA, there's red and yellow advertising schools. Go there and spend some time and get some knowledge, some formal knowledge, which you need as well. And at the same time, then get yourself some internships or get yourself some junior jobs in different industries and get involved. The biggest thing to me, and I'm on the board of a company, organization called AMASA, the Advertising Media Association of SA. And, you know, get involved with the company, organizations like AMASA then. You know, give back to the industry, see what's happening, get a feel for it. But show that you're interested. People will pick that up very quickly.
Yes.
And you'll go far. If it's just a job, you know, then get a job anyway. It's just a 9-to-5 job. It's going to show that it's just a job. You're going to pretty much sustain that job then. It's just job hop for R1,000 more each time.
Yeah.
But if you're passionate and you show your enthusiasm, you want to give back all the time, you're going to go far in whatever industry you choose. But if it's not working for you, change quickly. If you realize after a year, this actually isn't the industry I want to be in, no problem. Jump quickly. Don't get stuck and then 10 years later go, oh, why am I still here 10 years later?
Yeah.
Life's too short. Change quickly.
If it's a passion of yours and it drives you, you know, that little flame will be seen by a phenomenal leader like you, and you will just, all that you're going to do is just pour petrol on
exactly.
it.
Exactly.
It catches.
Exactly. So that's to me, find something that you're passionate about, and it'll take you amazing places.
Beautiful. Sir, may I call you my friend?
Absolutely.
So that's an honor for me. So it's I actually can't believe that you agreed to this section of the interview. I was like, what? Really? Are you serious? So it's that time of the interview where we're not in England now. We're in South Africa.
Good.
Mind you, in England, we also have hot Nando's food.
And I know, I used to get Nando's there, but they have proper restaurants.
Yes.
The one thing they have better than us, they have these beautiful olives, these really big olives.
Okay.
Which you don't get over here.
Probably South African, but exported because they pay
absolutely.
More.
Absolutely. Exactly.
So this section of the interview is where we get authentic. It's our own unique culture, our own unique brand, our own unique South Africanness, if I may. And we're going to finish the interview by having some hot food.
Absolutely.
Are you ready?
And I love chili and I love hot food.
Oh, wow. That scares me because I can't take it as well as most guests. So I'm going to try my best.
I even put chili on my eggs in the morning. I just chop up dried chilies.
Now I'm scared.
Well, I don't know. Let's see what we get.
We have finally arrived at the final table. We've got the chicken livers here. Because you are not a standard guest, you're a red hot leader. We've got some extra sauce in the food already. And if you feel brave enough, which I think you will be because you cut chilies in your breakfast, there's some of that fiery stuff on the side there. So, are you ready?
I'm ready. I'm even rolling up my sleeves over here.
You opted for no milk, just water. I've got milk, coffee, I've got water and a fire extinguisher behind my chair.
Well, I'm being brave now, but let's see.
Okay, there we go, sir. Let's get into it.
Thank you very much.
See what it does.
I look forward to this. Let's see.
So, from past experience, it's an experience.
Delicious and hot. Not as hot as the pili pili chicken in Lagos, though.
Really?
So that's cool.
Really?
It's delicious. I will start sweating soon. I'm pretty sure of it. Mm-hmm. Sure. Have you got the same heat as me?
Exactly the same.
Good,
sir.
So we can sweat together.
Yeah, it's proper. I can feel it. It's coming. if you'd like to maybe have an experience of that, sauce.
Is that even hotter?
Yeah, that's proper.
That's tasty. Sure.
Really?
That's tasty. Reminds me of this Malawian hot sauce called Nali.
Nali
sauce. A friend of mine, Aldi, is importing it from Malawi. Really hot little plastic bottles. Whoa. Very similar flavor.
Really?
That's hot though. Sure. Delicious, but hot.
Okay. Superhuman, not only in the leadership world, but in the taste buds. I've got my best acting skills on today because, man, it's hot.
I'm not able to talk in a moment, just have swollen tongue. Sure, okay. This red sauce is hot.
Yeah.
I need some to take home.
Good.
We'll have some water now.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm going to have some with you.
That's delicious. But certainly makes sort of sweat over here.
Let me compose myself.
Me too.
I'm not as tough as you are, sir. I must say. If you could spend an entire day with someone, who would it be and what would you ask that person?
Such an interesting question. You know, the one person I would like to spend the day with, living or dead, right?
Yes.
It was actually Leonardo da Vinci.
Wow.
You know, I want to see not just painting the Sistine Chapel and these things, but Was it Michelangelo? It was Leo.
Yeah.
This inventions he was building back then. I mean, he built like a helicopter.
Yes.
He built sort of almost advanced missile systems and put plans together for these things. All those hundreds of years ago. So I'd love to sit and think what was going on in his head. So me coming from the future to go, do you realize there actually is something called a helicopter that, you know, sorry, running nose from the heat. There is something like there's a helicopter today right now and you were really designing this. What was going on in your head? How did these ideas come to you?
How do you process
What's the creative things? Process that you get to these things? How do you start thinking about it and then start drawing it and designing these things, these amazing designs and paintings and sculptures and woodwork and machinery that he designs? This man is like, you know, unbelievable. That would just be so inspirational.
Beautiful. Now, this question hopefully takes us to a little bit of a dark side. Hopefully, I'm hoping for that. Maybe it doesn't, maybe it does. Not that we would. We would never, me and you would never. But if we could be flies on the wall and we could potentially overhear a conversation, who's in the room and what is being discussed, what would you love to eavesdrop on?
I'd love to be in the room eavesdropping on the conversations that the now ex-Prime Minister Liz Truss was having with her ministers when they were saying, I think it's time to go now. And she's going, no, I'll not go, I'm fine, I'm 6 weeks in power. It's going to, they say, no, it's time to go. You need to resign and get out of here now, it's not working. And I just hear how those conversations go down in those leadership, in those situations, whether it's in Donald Trump's office when, you know, he was told you've lost the election, he goes, no, I haven't. What's really being said?
Yes.
I just love to know what really happens. Because people say things publicly, and do they actually believe what they're saying? What's the real side? You know, those like those tapes that came up with Nixon, what he said back in the day. What's really happening behind the scenes? You know, what are people really thinking or saying? I would love to be a fly on the wall in Putin's Kremlin right now. Are his ministers and guys telling him, listen, it's a bad decision what you've done. You're losing in areas over there. You've lost world support. Or they're all saying you're doing the right thing. You're fantastic and nodding and waving because you're a dictator. They're too scared to say the truth.
Yes.
Just always curious about those things. You always think these leaders, do they really know what they say? Do they believe what they're saying? Or is it just for the cameras and behind the scenes that actually do have doubts? They do have real doubts. They're real human beings. Or they're just that... They just don't know any better. They have no EQ at all. They just think they're doing the right thing. And that they have this God complex, sometimes leaders, where they don't know that they're not perfect.
and you're right. It's very difficult to gauge, is it a censored answer or censored statement that is acceptable to society? Or is it really what came out of that person?
I think, again, that goes to politics, back to politics, is... So I'd love to sit in a room and hear what Ramaphosa's really being told or saying. You know, because he's very diplomatic and says the right things. But we know behind the scenes there's the two factions fighting like hell against each other. And there's all these sensitivities and, you know, will the, you know, radical economic transformation faction try to get, you know, the Zuma comeback. But front-facing is all very diplomatic. Does he know that we... have these issues on the ground every day.
Yeah. And
how's what's that, really happening?
And how's that conversation led in a boardroom or in a setting? Is it a calm, you know, allow each other to speak and raise the opinion? This is my point of view. Okay, makes sense. However, have you thought of this? Or is it a shouting match?
Yeah, that's the interesting thing. I'd love to know how these things are run. You know, I know that let's see, say Mandela was much more firm with his team and much more authoritarian, you know, which wouldn't have seemed from the outside.
Really? I would never guess.
Where Mbeki was a lot more, you know, let's discuss it in the sea. And so it's interesting what happens behind the scenes.
We had a guest on our show a couple of weeks ago that was the, and I'll share it, you know, everywhere I go, that was the presidential advisor to Nelson Mandela.
Wow.
Yeah, so he took, as a presidential advisor, he took three different South African presidents to meet three different American presidents.
Wow, as an advisor. Amazing.
Yeah. And he obviously had the opportunity to work with Madiba, who's someone that I've studied over the years. Mm. And I you know, that part where I asked you earlier, that ego, how do you take that, contain whatever you are feeling for your own, whether it's rage or look what's happened to me, and then do what's best for everybody else. So I admire him as a leader.
Absolutely, sure.
But he took Mandela to meet, at that stage it was Bill Clinton, and they met before 9/11. And the stories that he told us about Madiba was also, you're right, he was very hard. He, you know, I've got a high standard, this is what I want to achieve.
We help people accountable. But if he met you in the street, he'd make you feel important.
Yeah.
He'd make anyone feel important now. And he came to 702 once, about 92, 93.
So you had the opportunity
to
meet him.
I was next to him, seeing him speak to people. And then within a year later, he was at this first American trade show, USA something, I forget the name, but a friend of mine, an American friend, was running it. And he took Mandela around this whole exhibition there and said, you know, one day when you know, next year or so, he was president a year later, you know, this is the trade we want to do with you. And I walked with him, and just the way he spoke to people, he'd just talk to anybody, you know, and people felt, you know, special in his presence. Yeah. So he was very good. But he really had the leadership quality. You could feel it.
Yeah.
So you know, you could feel it, which is amazing.
Diane, I'm so excited to tell you the story. So Diane Brodrick, sitting on the couch, and she says, I've got a story about Mandela, and it's going exactly on what you just said. She's 22 years old. She's this young reporter that gets sent to report on Mandela, was just released, and she describes him as, you know, he's sort of looking down, and you know, he's being bashed at the moment, so he's getting tough feedback, so he's just looking down. And at a stage, she's staring at this man, and at a stage he looks up and he just smiles at her. And she said, you know, I felt like, you know, I was that person in the room that was important, just on what you said now.
Yeah, I know, fantastic man. He used to come to 702 often because he became really good friends with Deborah Patter, who was one of our lead journalists back in the time.
Tough lady.
But she was tough. Tough news. She also joined ETV. It's very tough, but very good.
Yeah.
And same thing, he used to love, you know, where's Deborah? You know, it was amazing.
Yeah.
It's just amazing, amazing man.
Very curious. I heard a 16 valve somewhere along the line. your first car. Please tell me it's a Golf.
So, my very first car was actually a Jeep.
A Jeep, okay.
It was my father bought it for me when I was 17, but he really bought it for himself. But he said he couldn't buy himself a car because he had a Mustang back then.
Wow.
Mother had the Merc, he had the Mustang. So he bought this Jeep, and it was a CJ6, 1978 model. We put big Dick Sepik 12.5-inch tires on it, and we had a roll bar, we had the seats redone, and the soft top, hard top, you know, the full works.
That goes with the guns and the
AVR. That was no doors on. That was my first car. So
I just felt
like a spoiled brat, but I did sell it to use the money to go travel around Europe, and when I went to Europe and stayed there. So it was a great first car, except petrol was very expensive. It was a straight six. I think it was a 4.1 litre straight six. Cost a fortune in petrol. I used to fill up probably every second day, my father's corporate account for his company. They said, fill it up. One day I went there and I said, no, your father said, you can't fill it up anymore. I said, what do you mean? He said, because you come here all the time, just pulling in petrol, and you take your friends around, this costs a fortune. He stopped me. So then I started hitching to this.
More conservative ones.
Yeah,
you have to pull
petrol. I had to pay for myself. Then it was a different story. You can imagine.
So what is your dream car? If you were like, wow, when I think about this, this fires me up, this excites me.
I think a dream car, I was looking at new cars, probably that new, the new 911 Turbo S Porsche. Ooh,
I like your style.
You know, that is just, that's something else.
That's a rocket.
It's still kind of a little bit subdued, it's not flash.
It's not the RS3 version or...
No, it's just, it's, you know, there's amazing cars out there, but this does the business, it's fast, it's beautiful, it's... And also, I think I'm also inspired because my one cousin works for Porsche. So occasionally I get these videos. One was in a 911 Turbo S driving down a mountain road. It was snow and ice, and he was driving flat out. And my other cousin was filming it. But he works for Porsche, knows how to drive. I'd kill myself probably, but that would be the car.
Beautiful.
My wife is saying not a chance. We still need four seats. We got four people in the family.
Well, you know? I hope so very, very soon. You buy one in every color. That's what I wish for.
Amen. But the 16 valve was the car I bought when I came back from London. I had a little City Golf, then I bought a 16 valve GTR 2 liter.
And that's the Golf
2. The Golf 2.
The jumbo.
The small little steering wheel with a big 16V in it. Oh. I had it tuned up. And
what color? Black?
It was gunmetal silver. Gunmetal. Yeah, the dark silver. So, sure, that was a great car.
Fun car. We still now and then see them. They're very sought after at the moment.
Yeah,
so,
wow.
Awesome car.
It was a great car. It's fun.
Books. You're a book lover. I don't need to ask you, I know, because that amount of knowledge is downloaded over many, many years of reading and researching and applying and readjusting and doing that. If you could share perhaps maybe your favorite one or two books on leadership and perhaps your top three books that you felt, wow, this was cool, this made an impact, it gave me a new perspective, a new angle, a new lens.
I think the one that's sort of more on leadership, there was a book by Stephen Covey years ago, which I've reread a couple of years ago, just about first things first. It's all about prioritizing. And it speaks again to focusing on the important, not the urgent. And that's the thing we have to keep remembering, because we often get sucked into the vortex, just getting stuff done, emails, just emailing back, you know, just, you think, what am I here just to send emails? So it's again about the principles of focusing on the important stuff. And finding time to, if you, not that I play golf, but if there was time to play golf, you should have time in your day to play golf. Not, I'm always busy. You got to find time, because we just get sucked into all the urgent, not the important. So that's the one book. And then there's so many books, I couldn't even, honestly, I read one from the founder of LinkedIn about the founder's mentality. The
founder's mentality.
And I'll get the name of the book and I'll send it. And that's about when you work anywhere, the founder's mentality is where you take ownership of what you're doing. Not just a job. I actually feel like I'm part of this company. I'm one of the founders. I have a vested interest in making this company succeed. And if all your people in the company have a founder's mentality, you're going to make the company succeed. It's not just a job. You're going to go the extra mile. You're not going to just say, this is my job, that's not my job. You get involved everywhere to make things a success.
I'm a business owner.
Yeah, so, and I even say to the sales guys sometimes, this is your own little franchise. I've given you a little franchise. This is your franchise. Run it, and we're giving you all the backup. But make it succeed. See, this is your own little franchise. You know, you are the, you know, you have a personal brand as well. You know, it could be Wayne Bischoff Pty Limited.
Yes.
But make it work. It's almost that founder's mentality coming through. So books around that resonate a lot with me. And then obviously everything around just having empathy and EQ and leading through kindness. You know, that's really important for me. But also making sure people achieve. And excellence is always the goal. Leveling up all the time, trying to get better each time, you know, and trying to be the best you can be. That to me is critical. Then more on the personal side, I also read a ton of books over the years. The one recent one that stands out for me was my wife's book, actually. It's called The Choice.
The Choice.
Is it Edith Eger, I think her name is. She's a Holocaust survivor. She's in her 90s, and she went into Auschwitz as a young, you know, a teenage Jewish girl with her family, and I think her parents died in the camp, in Auschwitz. She actually, after her parents were murdered in the camp, she actually had to dance for Josef Mengele. Remember the mad Nazi scientist, because she was a top dancer. And for years and years and years, she survived, but she never wanted to speak about those times or the awfulness of what she's seen and. You know, how she was rescued half dead by American soldiers in the camps. They want to speak about it, and she had this, what they call survivor's guilt, where everyone else around me died and I survived. You know, why did I didn't deserve to survive. And a lot of people have that trauma.
Yes.
And they almost, she said, that you jail yourself, you get stuck in the past. So she went back to the camps and she writes about this, and eventually she's changed to get to a point where, no, I made a choice to not you know, be depressed all the time, but to the opposite of depression is expression, where she expresses herself and says, no, I made a choice to survive. I have the right to survive and to live a wonderful life and to learn from what I went there, to face up and to talk about it. Not to, don't ever talk about the awfulness. I want to talk about it, hear about it, tell people about it. And that she's come to terms with. And from being a survivor, now she coaches people around the world in, who've been through trauma and, you know, and how to get through it and how to have a joyful life. You know, it's, and it just speaks about the resilience of the human spirit, that someone's come through the worst of the worst of the worst, has managed to turn around, use it as a springboard to better things. Not just live in permanent guilt and trauma about, you know, I went through awfulness and I shouldn't have survived. No, to use it as a positive. And you know, I think you have to read the book, but it's amazing just to say what some people have been through the worst and they've managed to get through. What we've been through is nothing.
Yes.
And they use it in a positive way to help others. Yes. She's a top psychologist now, you know, and she's in her 90s and she's strong and
wow,
amazing. So that book, The Choice, is a wonderful book.
We'll make sure that we put a link on that.
Yeah, I'll send you details on that. It's amazing.
The video. Beautiful. Yeah. Thank you very much for sharing. Wow. Sir, what's next? What are you excited about? What are you looking forward to? What in your career fires you up like? I know my alarm clock is going off. What time do you wake up, though, as busy as you are?
5:30.
5:30.
Yeah.
So what gets you up at 5 a.m. doing this? Like, I can't wait for this day to start.
I think you always got to have a purpose in life.
Yes.
What are you getting up for? Is it just to do the same old, then you're going to go nowhere. But what are you going to achieve that day? And it's always trying to achieve one or two, at least every day, finish the day saying, I achieved X. Something must have been ticked off that list or yes, whatever. What fires me up these days, we've got a really big drive around in the digital space. So we have our FM radio stations, and we expanded them to the full, what we call the full ecosystem. So you've got FM, but you've got also digital audio and podcasting and social media. There's that full ecosystem around the FM radio brand, which amplifies clients, advertising, and you get direct feedback from customers because it's digital.
Yes.
So we're pushing hard in the digital audio side of business. We have even technology called AdsWiz. So if you want to say, I only want to reach people in a 5 kilometer radius
of
this area. I want to find out how many listeners are listening, online listening to Jacaranda. I can target the 5 kilometer radius and I can hyper target them. So the ad they hear on the streaming Jacaranda service won't be the same one they hear on FM.
Interesting. I love that.
You can hyper-target, you get the metrics back, you know what you've reached, who you've reached, what the feedback loop is.
Beautiful.
So the digital is adding another element to the engagement levels of FM radio. So that's exciting. Because I will say, I heard your ad on the radio, I've heard about it, now can I find you? So now you have to make sure you have a responsive website. So I can find you, I can engage with you, now that I've found you, can I trust you? What do the recommendations say?
Yes.
What do social media say about you? If I trust you, can I engage with you? Can I do e-com? Whatever, you need a feedback loop.
Yes.
So people, you need the full digital funnel, as it were, not just, yes, you know, traditional media has the most important place, but it takes you down the line.
Congruency.
So,
it
yeah,
needs to back up what
exactly
you've advertised.
The full integrated marketing approach. So we're looking for a business. We have a business within a business running our digital assets that we represent. So we represent MSN and D6, which is a school app. We've recently been signed up exclusively Warner Music,
wow,
WMX. So within YouTube, any Warner artist, whether it's Dua Lipa or Ed Sheeran, any Warner official Warner artist, is you want to advertise in there as a client in YouTube, you have to go through MediaMarkt now. And we give you the granularity, the data you can target.
Beautiful.
And they've already got nearly 7 million unique browsers in a month. So that's exciting for me. So this division has all these digital assets and platforms to help you engage more with clients. And we're basically looking at how can we improve that? What more can we get in there? Do we restructure this division? Do we invest in a technology company in the digital space that can actually do proper automated digital marketing for us? Do we go down the route of offering smaller businesses that full funnel of digital opportunities, of full marketing stack, from websites to e-commerce to social media to SEO to Google? We can do the whole lot. So that's exciting. That's what we're moving to. to offer more than just the one side, but to offer a full digital solution to our clients.
Beautiful.
And that's where that's exciting stuff for the future. And we've got great investors and shareholders who are willing to invest in that. So if I find a great digital media company or digital solutions company or something I can invest in, they'll put the money up to do that. So,
sir, you've experienced the hotness of the food. I hope you've had some fun. In your professional opinion, who do you think is a good fit for our next guest, and perhaps who would you like to challenge to come in and have a runny nose and a little bit of a sweat?
I'm definitely going to challenge my CFO, Jerry Singh. Let's see if he can manage this hot food the way I have without breaking into a sweat. He's a fascinating man. He can talk about his 30 motorbikes as well. Been in the media space for sort of 30 plus years and a really interesting chap. So let's see if he can eat this without sweating.
It sounds amazing. Sir, the deepest appreciation for you and your time from myself, the entire team. We've asked you a whole bunch of questions off camera. We've written down a bunch of notes. You know, the value of this interview, I believe, to the end user is priceless. I'm not pushing, you know, a credit card company, but it really is. Thank you very much. You have left us a lot better than you found us. I really appreciate your time. Thank you for sharing it with us, and all the best. I know everything you touch will turn into a win because of the leader that
you are. I'm humbled, and it's wonderful sitting here with you and getting to know you and making you my friend. So thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Thank you. I enjoyed the food as well.
Sure, the food's hot and delicious. The tongue was going, the eyes were going, the nostrils were starting to leak.
You took it like a champion, so well done.
Thank you very much. Thank you.